we go back to the history at IIT Bombay, you will recall Professor Vasi mentioned that encouraging entrepreneurship has been an ambition for very many years. And this ambition was fueled by the successes of many of our past students who picked up entrepreneurship as an activity rather than taking up jobs. Many of them picked up entrepreneurship as a choice after going to US, getting a degree, typically doing a BTEC here, doing master's there, working for a few years, and then taking up entrepreneurship as an activity. And many of them have been trying to inculcate that spirit across the country, even otherwise through the interaction that some of our faculty members had with them. There was this feeling that we should actually encourage entrepreneurship actively through some promotional activities and by setting up some kind of a cell here. The original ideas were S&T parks, you know, science and technology parks, which was the common thing. We even thought of creating one across the pipeline in our campus where we have some free space. We're still thinking of doing that. But nothing concrete had emerged. In the Department of Computer Science, meanwhile, in 96-97, there was another debate that was raging. And that debate related to the need to emphasize the applied side of computer science. As you know, traditionally, the computer science or computer science and engineering syllabi the world over concentrate on internals of computers. So you have theory, you have architecture, you have operating systems, you have compilers, you have databases, but database engine. What people do with all these tools is generally not a part of the computer science research agenda of any research institution in computer science. Typically, there are a few individuals from within the computer science department who work closely with researchers in other fields where the computers are required to be used. So whether it is mechatronics or robotics as was known those days, or whether it was signal and image processing as was known to electrical engineering people, or whether it was chemical plant simulation and optimization as was known to the chemical engineering people, or whether it was finite element analysis which was used heavily by all structural people in civil engineering or wherever, those people used to carry out applied research. And very few, if any, from the computer science discipline per se would be actively participating. Many of us felt that that is not correct. It is important to actually do active research in the applied part of the computers as well. And we were trying to recruit faculty in areas which will focus on the applications. It was not very easy because the ethos of a computer science and engineering department academically insists that everybody should have something to do with core. In fact, some of us realized that this vertical partitioning of education is not permitting interaction between people from different disciplines for doing cutting-edge research. They would collaborate here and there. You would have noticed it even in your own fields. For example, students of computer science in your own colleges would generally not appreciate the importance of learning principles of mechanical engineering or civil engineering as much as the five-year program engineers used to do at one time. There is a difference there. And this difference was getting accentuated. Just before that, the School of Management was established in IIT a few years before that. And the notion of a school as an entity which engages only in postgraduate education and in research was fairly well established. So some of us, Professor Sada, myself, and a few others, proposed that we should set up a school which will focus on the applications and applied side of the research. And in order to name it slightly different from the computer science, we said we'll call it School of Information Technology, because information technology by then was an accepted phrase. At one time, you'll recall, there was no information technology. In fact, even computer science undergraduate programs in this country started only in early 80s. Till then, there were only MTech programs in computer science. At my time, as a matter of fact, in late 60s, when I came here, or till early 70s, there was not even a computer science MTech. There used to be an MTech in electrical engineering with specialization in computers, controls, instrumentation, etc. So this is, of course, the history. And as again was mentioned, the IT boom was actually almost at its peak in 96, 97, 98, and we thought we could sort of ride upon it because the need was felt for applied education. In India, we have this program called Master of Computer Applications. I think somebody is there who is an MCA student here. So Master of Computer Application was actually introduced to focus on the applied side, more on the software systems and so on. When we mooted this idea, the then director, Professor Sukhatme, said, looks like a good idea, but institute does not have any money to support such an idea. You will recall that in 91, when the nation embraced free market economy, it also put a spanner on the funding of the institutions like IITs. Earlier, the IIT money used to be given based on the budget and therefore based on the projected activities. In 94, the government announced that henceforth a fixed amount annually will be given. Now you run your existing programs, pay your salaries or run new program, whatever you want to. Which means effectively that initiatives different from whatever was going on was not feasible to be supported. So the idea of setting up a separate school was considered to be a good idea, at least in the leadership, but we were told very plainly that there will be zero money available. So we said we will try and raise funds for this activity. I had just finished my term as Dean of Resources, although I had not succeeded in generating a lot of resources, but I had set up a strong alumni network. And it was very obvious to me that all our alumni have a very strong feelings for the institution. They have a great soft corner. This would be true, by the way, the alumni of any institution. Like all of us would recall fondly the days when we studied in a college. It is just that that feeling is never translated into actual action because we all become busy in our own way of life, and sadly the institutions become busy in themselves and they forget us. So we had tried to bridge that gap. We had built a good alumni network and we said we'll try getting some funding from the alumni. This is the backdrop. In the School of IT, I had two very, I would say, important things in my mind, that apart from carrying out postgraduate education and R&D in applied computer science, it should also initiate things which we pursued were important in the long term, one of which was business incubation, and the other was distance education, because we felt that the skills which are required in the faculty training, in the student training, are so enormous that unless we exploit this new technology, we will not be able to match those skills. And just as an aside, recall that if we conduct a QIP program, some of you would have attended those QIP programs, or take a program like this, not more than 20, 25, 30 people at one time can actually leave their place of work and go all the way away. So unless you take the education to wherever people are, you will not be able to address. This 25, 30 people, by the way, was perfectly all right when we had about 50 to 70 engineering colleges. So about 5 IITs running such programs every summer or winter was adequate. But when you have 2,000 engineering colleges, and when the number of faculty teaching these students, more than 2 million students, is roughly 100,000, there's no way you can reach even a minuscule percentage of them through the convention. One of the reasons why we, by the way, are capturing this audio-visual recording and circulating it under open source is so that this material can reach people. But anyway, so these two were the initiatives that we wanted. This we were discussing around 1996, 97. 98 was an important year because 98, the institute students started an activity called Tech Fest or Technical Festival. Some of you might have heard of this. Technical Festival is now almost the Asia's largest event. About 30,000 engineering students come from all over the country and rest of the world to IIT Bombay today. That time it was an early event sort of. It is essentially technical competitions, technical quizzes, technical showcases, lectures, etc., etc. There were a couple of initiatives woven around TechFest. One was called the Inspirations. The other was called Eureka. Eureka was a business plan competition. Today, business plan competition is almost a common name, common noun. Everybody knows. Everybody conducts business plan competition. IIMs do that very effectively. But in those days, it was a novel thing for a technology institution to undertake. So we said we'll have business plan competitions which will emphasize technology innovation, whether it is development of a product or modification of a product or any process or something using cutting edge technology, and how to build business around it. So that team was working towards this 1998 Tech Fest. And when I said I'm interested in this kind of activity, so I was part of that Eureka activity then. My colleague, Professor Chandorkar from Electrical Engineering Department, was spearheading the whole Tech Fest team. In fact, we call it a dream team. I have actually taken a photograph of this photo and I'm including it in the course material along with the names. These are the people involved. In fact, the rightmost person whom you may briefly see is Kashyap Devra, who along with Myzu's CEO, Roshan De Silva, whom you met, were the CEOs of the first two companies admitted to our incubator later. At this time, there was no incubator. They were just spearheading that activity. And the Tech Fest actually conducted the first business plan competition based on the technology products in 1998. During that time, I was busy gathering support for the idea of setting up a school along with these initiatives when one of our distinguished alumni, Kamal Rekhi, came here. Some of you would have heard his name. He was an entrepreneur. In the early days of networking, he set up a company called Excellen. So all of us are familiar with network interface cards today. I mean, network interface card does not, as a matter of fact, even come as a separate product. It is integrated into the motherboard of most of the systems. But I'm talking about the days when the networking was in its infancy. So he built that company, produced those network interface cards. That company was taken over by Novell. He became CTO of Novell then. And later on, he became a venture capitalist. He and some of his colleagues who were successful entrepreneurs in the Bay Area had set up an organization called TAI. TAI stands for the Indus Entrepreneur. So they said in the Indus region, they deliberately did not name it India. It is not India, it's called Indus. And the purpose is as follows. They said that we'll cross geographical boundaries to define this Indus region. So right from Iran, Afghanistan, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Nepal, India, all these people here, they believed that somehow, since most of them came from this region, they believed that they must take this message to people of origin from the Indus region and convert them into entrepreneurs. In fact, their objective was very simple, stated in simple words: take every Indian, inject a dose of entrepreneurship, and convert that person into an entrepreneur. That's the ambition. Even today, they continue with that ambition. This was set up in Bay Area, and there were many people who were the sort of founding fathers. Kamal was one of them. You might have heard the name of Dr. Suhas Patil. He's another entrepreneur. He was actually a faculty member, like many of us, after doing his PhD. But he set up an electronic chip design company, led it successfully. And most of these people, by the time 96, 97, 98 came, they had started this enterprise where they were mentoring individuals who wanted to set up companies. So this activity was happening in Bay Area. 98 January, Kamal Rekhi came to India, came to IIT. He had come here earlier in 94, and at that time he had indicated a great displeasure, saying, why are my hostels in a dilapidated condition? We tried to tell him that, look, the funding has suddenly been squeezed, so we can merely run our existing program, but we don't have money to either start new ones or to maintain the infrastructure well. And he was a bit upset. So in 98, when he came, he offered a small donation just to take care of a few things like library and so on. And at that time, I happened to talk to him about the idea of the School of IT. He was not so much interested in the School of IT in terms of the academic programs, but he was immensely interested in one of the two initiatives, namely Business Incubation. So he immediately said, if you start Business Incubation, I'll give you $1 million of matching grant. And I told him, I can't start the Business Incubator unless there is a School of IT. So he thought for a while, he says, all right, I will give that $1 million in the name of the school, but you must use it to ensure that the Business Incubation activity starts. $1 million in those days, by the way, was a very large sum. A dollar still goes a long way now. It went a long way then. More importantly, it was the first major donation offer from any one of our alumni to IIT Bombay then. Nowadays, of course, most of the people, we have established channels of communication and so on, and we get a lot of funding, but that was the first major offer. With that, then, I piloted the proposal of school in the Senate, Institute Senate. And it's very interesting. I wanted to take a sabbatical leave to move around the country to visit engineering colleges, which I did in 2002 later. But 98, when I applied for the sabbatical, Professor Sukhatme said, your proposal is pending in the Senate. If Senate throws out that proposal, you go and take your sabbatical leave. If Senate approves it, you better be here and set up the school. So that was the condition. Professor Sarda, my colleague, who will be talking to you tomorrow, was appointed by the Senate as the chairperson of that committee. Committee comprised of 4 or 5 faculty members from here, head of the School of Management, and some other professors. 2 external experts, one Ashank Desai, who is the creator of Mastek, an IT company many of you might have heard. He is the chairman of Mastek even now. And Dr. Anand Deshpande, who is the chairman and managing director of a company called Persistent Systems in Pune. Both are IT companies. And the committee deliberated for almost 2 months, figuring out what to do, et cetera, et cetera. And the report that they prepared was a very detailed report. They all endorsed such a requirement. And you should see the kind of maramari that we have, or the fighting that we have over trivial issues in arithmetic. I'll just give you 2 glimpses. One is, what should be the size of a faculty office? Traditionally in IIT, a faculty office is 10 by 10. Because 10 by 10, 10 feet by 30 feet is the size of a bay in a large shed, in a lab. And typically the corner portion of that bay would be the faculty cabins. So in a 10 by 30 thing, there will be 3 faculty cabins. And people used to, faculty members used to sit in the labs. It was an unknown notion in 50s and 60s that faculty members would have nice cabins and so on. Air conditioning was unheard of. I insisted on a size of 300 square feet, not 100 square feet. The argument, and I was supported then by Professor Vasi, who was not a deputy director but was a professor then, and his argument was that, look, faculty members spend half their lifetime in their offices. Only their families live full time in homes. So if they spend half their lifetime in offices, should we not make offices as comfortable as homes? So the then dean planning, who was to weigh the judgments, then he did an arithmetic average and says, all right, 200 square feet. So you'll find in this building, all offices are 200 square feet office. It's better than 100 square feet, but not as good as 300. Then the total area, how much should be the total area that is required? So the total area requirement, I said a minimum 50,000 square feet. And the dean planning said, no, not more than 25,000 square feet. So again, Professor Sarada as chairman did the arithmetical mean magic and came up with 36,000 square feet as the requirement for this school. The committee report was submitted to Senate. Senate argued about it. Senate approved it on one condition. No money from IIT's budget should be spent on this. Otherwise, we are okay with this. So I had the task of having only $1 million promised. The requirement of funding was, to my mind, I would require more than 50,000 square feet. I would create a lot of corpus funds to support faculty research, travel, student scholarship, etc., etc. And I said I would need about 16 crore rupees. Those days, dollar was about 40 rupees, almost same as it is now. He says 16 crore rupees is what I would require. And I had $1 million, just 4 crore rupees promised. I had to still generate, matching funds. This was a matching grant, it's not an absolute grant. But the Senate approved this, the board approved it. And I went in September to meet Kamal Rekhi. And I still remember that meeting where I went with our alumni association president, Mr. Anil Kshirsagar. And we explained to him, we thanked him. What the board had done, by the way, in the meanwhile, was to acknowledge his contribution, because that was the largest contribution ever seen by IIT. The board chairman, Professor M.G. K. Menon, had Suomoto suggested in the board that we should name the school after Kamal Rekhi. So that is how the school name came to be Kamal Rekhi School of IT. We went and told him, he was very happy. He says, although that was not the purpose of my giving this donation, but anyway, I'm happy. And when we got to discuss this, I kept mentioning that we will start with a small building and then we'll eventually grow, etc., because we need 16 crore rupees. He listened to us for 2 minutes and then suddenly asked Anil Kshirsagar, Professor Phatak is mentioning 16 crore, what is this 16 crore, how much is that? Anil promptly translated to say $4 million. That's the first time he understood that the reason why I'm saying small, he asked me, so since I'm giving you $1 million matching grant, that means you will have only 2 million at best. Is that the reason why you want to start small? I said, yes. Will my incubator suffer? I said, no, we'll start it. Then he thought for a second and impulsively said, no, Professor Phatak, we want IIT Bombay to build the best of breed infrastructure. Don't compromise. I'll give you $2 million matching. Generate another 2 million, but don't compromise. Now, this is the kind of goodwill that the institute has been able to create amongst at least some. I still had a problem. I had only promised money because his condition was, show me a matching dollar and spend a dollar. He had given all of his $2 million to Heritage Fund, which was the funding part of the Alumni Association in the US. The fund had cash, but the fund had no permission to use that money unless I generated the other. Then I got a call from my friend Narayan Murthy of Infosys, who had actually done something about funding for some programs in computer science in IIT Kanpur, because he was from IIT Kanpur. Although nobody in IIT Kanpur would talk about how much funding he has given. I came to know later that he had put an embargo on them talking about his funding. He called me saying, Deepak, Nandan would like to do something. And I said, that's wonderful. So I talked to Nandan in the first week of January 99, I remember. And he says, I thought he wants, since I had no clue about the kind of quantum they wanted to donate, Nandan wanted, I thought he will give some chair or something like that. And when I called him, I was very pleasantly surprised when I said, I want to give $1 million. So I said, $1 million? He says, yes, I want to match whatever Kamal did. Quite inadvertently, I ended up telling him, oh, but Kamal is giving $2 million. And then he said, oh, and then waited for some time. And I got really scared. I mean, I said, no, Nandan, $1 million is okay. I mean, then he says, no, let me think about it. Believe me, that night I could not sleep. Because if that fellow goes back and says, I'm not giving anything, I'm stuck. He came back 2 days later, apparently discussed with Rohini, his wife, whatever. Because these donations are from personal money. It's not Infosys money or anything. And Nandan called, he says, no, I have decided to match Kamal. So if he gives $2 million, I'm also giving $2 million. Within about 10 days, the Infosys shares were given to IIT Bombay. They helped us sell them because IIT cannot hold shares as a government institution. So we had to discharge those shares. We got money, and that is how you see this building. In 98, after the school was established, I started both setting up the academic programs, the incubator, and distance education program. Distance education program required a detailed evaluation of VSAT technologies and so on, which were just coming up then. It took some time. But to the incubator, I said, I'll start the incubator immediately. So in 1999, when we admitted the first batch of students, we were given 6 faculty rooms, 2 classrooms, and some office space in the annex of the computer science department in the old maths building. Since I had only 3 faculty members, I had 3 rooms free. So I converted 2 of the faculty rooms, the great 10 by 10 rooms, into incubator. And I announced the beginning of a pilot incubator. That is when we were doing the evaluation, as I said, about the proposals and so on came in. Kashyap's proposal was backed by suggestions from Rakesh Mathur, who was his mentor. You might not have heard of Rakesh Mathur. Rakesh was the creator of Jungly. Have you heard of a startup called Jungly? It was sold to Amazon later. After Yahoo, Jungly, I mean, those of you who have seen the Jungly movie would recall these terms. They had set up Jungly. He made a lot of money in Jungly, which he has been spending in setting up various serial enterprises. He still has an incubating company which just exited recently called Webaru from IIT Bombay. Those days he said, okay, I will be mentoring him, though there was no promise of any funding or something at that time. And the second was Roshan De Silva's company, MyZeus, which had won the top award in our own competition, the product competition Eureka. There were about 25 applications which we had shortlisted in the first round out of about 150 that we got. You must go back to those days. Every Tom, Dick and Harry wanted to set up an IT company. Those were the days of anybody and everybody. And most of the people believed that you generally set up some website and money will pour in. It took quite some time to people to figure out that that doesn't happen that way. But that was the ethos. So these two companies were promptly given space there. There was no formalism of any kind available. It was clear that even my modified proposal, not to charge them any monthly rental, but to hold some stake in that company, could not be implemented for 2 simple reasons. One, the companies themselves did not exist as proper entities. Nobody knew amongst these students when how to set up a proper company, register it and whatever. They were in the process of doing. Second, IIT Bombay, as I said, had no mechanism to hold stock. My idea was that I will charge some 3% stock or 6% stock or 5% stock or something like that. And which they were very glad to give, but there's no way. I mean, IIT Bombay can't hold it. I can't hold it personally. Nobody can hold it. So what does one do? Fortunately, both these startup companies were IIT Bombay alumni started companies. So I invoked the traditional Indian teacher's role. I said, you give me a word of honor that in future, whenever a formal mechanism is set up, you will either give this share or you will donate the equivalent of this money to IIT Bombay or whichever is the agency. They agreed. Can you imagine doing this formally whenever you are using money which is given by a government institution? It would be very difficult. Department of Science and Technology, any other department, any other government agency will ask you for your defined processes, will ask you for whatever are your legal terms. Fortunately, today, you have such definitions of processes and it is possible to set things up. In 98, there was nothing. Why I'm telling you all this is that there are occasions, if not this, there will be something else which you may not be able to fulfill when you are in the early days of setting up the incubator. You have to find out some novel ways and you have to find out that if there are no rules, you don't care, but you still start with it. After all, I said it's a pilot. The reason Institute supported me was twofold. One, a genuine faith in the idea and in the objectives from the entire leadership of the institution. the then director, Professor Sukhatme, deputy director, other deans, and even later when Professor Ashok Mishra joined as director, and the other deans, they have always said, yes, this idea is correct. The second is, there is no government funding involved. In fact, I specifically asked Kamal as to what are his conditions for spending these $2 million. And his answer was a typical of a good venture capitalist. He asked me, who is going to set up the school? So I said, I have been appointed the head. So all right. So he says, you got 3 years. In 3 years, you show me something world-class happening. Otherwise, I shall have a strong private word with you. This is my only condition. I don't want to put any other condition. I think IIT Bombay has enough wisdom to spend that money wisely. And it has enough processes and checks and balances. So I have nothing else to do. You don't get this kind of freedom easily. You certainly don't get this kind of freedom from government agency. And it is also wrong to expect that kind of freedom because they have their own rules. I am not suggesting that it is a precondition to set up a successful incubator to have large amount of free money to come up with. Why? Because even if this money was not coming, we were still committed to start this activity anyway. As a matter of fact, I did not use any one of this funding for the incubator. I used 1 crore rupees of Nandan's funding to set up the incubator. The rest of the money was used to build up the infrastructure, to set up other endowments and so on, as I said. Out of that 1 crore rupee, 70 lakh rupees or 65 lakh rupees have been given back to Sign after Sign was established. The money required was not very large. How wisely you spend that money is what is important. The pilot started growing because there was a pressure for more people wanting to get in. We did not have space in the, because meanwhile more faculty members had joined. And as a matter of fact, within 2 months another faculty member was to come and one of the two companies had to exit or move out somewhere. So I went around the department saying, will somebody give me space? Why should anybody give you space? In your own infrastructure, how easy do you think it is to go to some other head of the other department and say, please give me 5 rooms for 1 year. Will you get that? Not easy. In Mumbai, people don't even give up the place on footpath if they have occupied it for sleeping in the night. So giving a built-up space was absolutely impossible. Then I offered a shop. I said, I want a lab space which I'm going to convert into these 5 or 6 cabins. They will be air-conditioned, they will be furnished, and they will all have PCs in those rooms. If you give me place for 1 year, I will leave all of that behind. Now that appeared attractive to physics department who were not getting enough computer purchase grant, enough air conditioning grant. So they said, we'll give you space. I had asked for 600 square feet. They said, no, we'll give you 1,000 square feet. And you must buy more pieces and leave all of them with us. So the head of the physics department and some few professors negotiated a good deal. Professor Puntambekar was the head physics then. Professor Deepan Ghosh, who was our deputy director till recently, was the person who told the head to give me more space than what I had asked for. But this was a good internal negotiation. And Arvind Patil, whom you will be meeting shortly, he will be telling you how the initial infrastructure, etc., was set up. He actually set that up in record time along with some of my project assistants and so on. Within 4 months, we could shift these two companies there and we could admit more companies. Meanwhile, the construction of this building was coming up. Again, Arvind Patil was in charge of this infrastructure creation. Even in this infrastructure creation, we had a problem. Traditionally, our buildings have to come through what you call the PWD approved rules, which typically means the lowest tender and so on. And we went to our building and works committee and said that, look, we are not spending any government money in it. We do want to follow the same processes, but permit us to choose the best constructing agencies. Amongst them, whosoever is the lowest will award the contract. They actually agreed. So it was like Shapurji Palanji, L&T, and one or two more companies whom we asked for this construction. The lowest bid was by Larsen & Toubro, and we said, you construct. So you can see the structural construction, the L&T engineer was on site. He was so proud, he took me towards the end and showed me a big pillar that you see there. He says, sir, we have given a guarantee of 60 years for this construction to last, but I am telling you it will last for 75 years. I jokingly told him, neither you nor I will be there. He says, no, your grandson will be there. Ask him to meet my grandson then. This is the level of confidence and pride that they have. And that is the advantage. We were aware that when we choose one of the best agencies in the country, we will end up spending 15 to 20% more money than what an L1 thing would do. But you will all agree that an L1 construction would probably disappear in 20 years. Now that's a difference that you have to somehow find ways to do it. Another person who has done it using government money, not necessarily in the context of Business Incubator, but in terms of the infrastructure for the institution, is one Professor Tiwari in a place called Allahabad, where Indian Institute of Information Technology, IIIT, Allahabad is situated. I went and saw that. The entire money is funded by the government, but he went to his board and got the same permission, saying we want to construct the best of the breed thing, and he got the permission. So the government is not, you know, necessarily against good quality. The government only wants that you follow properly defined processes and execute. Anyway, I digress a bit. So coming back to this incubation then, there was a problem. I was also learning. I had only read about these incubators. I had visited a few incubators, but I had no idea on how to run one. Typically, I used to spend practically all my time here, because we all live on the campus. You know, it's very common for some of us to come back to the departments after dinner, and we'll work till about 2, 2.30, 3 o'clock, whatever, go back home at that time. So we would get ample time to interact with these students. And that was the time when I used to spend with these incubating companies. Couple of instances, very interesting example. This was, I think, Kashyap's company. So I hear at 2 o'clock when I'm walking off, some discussion going on. In front of those faculty rooms, there was a small discussion area which was commonly utilized. And I went and I overheard some negotiations going on. So one fellow sitting with his back to me was saying, but the other company is giving 1%. So I did not understand what it was. And he says, why should I take your 0.5% offer or something? And Kashyap was there, or his colleague was there, he was saying, no, but my 0.5% will be better than that fellow's 1% when you do the valuation. Then I went and found out that the fellow was sitting was the prospective gold medalist in the computer science department. And both the startups were trying to hire him for summer. And since they had no salary to pay, they were offering him stock option. So he says, 0.5% for one summer, or 1% for one summer. These are the innovative ways in which you can get the early contributions from talented individuals if you have no money to share. Reason I give this example is to stress that while money is important, money is not necessarily the only thing. If you are innovative, you can actually work out. After all, the startup entirely is a dream. So anybody who starts up a dream is a dream merchant. And if you can sell that dream merchant to me as an incubator runner or a dream to a venture capitalist, he should surely be able to sell that dream to a startup, to the prospective employees. Today in Bay Area, if you join a startup, you actually get salary, plus you additionally get some stocks. So this is almost a common standard thing these days. One of the rules of thumb that I have understood from people is that originally when you set up a company, you own 100%. Typically, you should set aside 40% for venture capitalists, 40% for yourself, and 20% for the employees. That is considered a reasonably good thumb rule for wealth distribution. Of course, there will be differences depending upon the valuation and how much money you need and whatever, whatever. We figured this out and we tried to tell the startup companies, which increased from 2 to 4 to 7 to 10 later. The mentoring that happened actually happened inadvertently, in the sense that I myself did not know many of the tricks of the trade in the startup business myself. I was learning with them. Every time anybody from the Thai group or anybody from the Bay Area would come, I would arrange a lecture. So I remember most of the people would have late night flights from here back to US. 12 o'clock, 2 o'clock, some of you would be familiar. And they would have day-long appointments. I would invite them for an after-dinner meeting. And they would typically come here at 8:30, 9, 9:30, spend about half an hour, 1 hour with the people, with the incubatee people, and then go back. And that turned out to be very useful, because the youngsters, what they are looking at is actually at role models. They don't want sermons. They want assistance, help, and they want role models. While interacting with me might have been useful to them, it was not as exciting as listening to Dr. Suhas Patil or Jagdish or someone who actually has done this, succeeded, or even if he has failed, he has succeeded again. That kind. Plus the amount of insight these people brought to the table. They were able to discuss nitty-gritties of the individual projects depending upon the areas in which they work. It was absolutely valuable input. Thankfully, I was connected with the business and finance industry in the country, because I do a lot of consulting with banks and other people. I had a part in the network of people who then became part of the VC funding agencies in the country. So therefore, it was possible to relate to those people, bring them here and so on. Sign does it now very, very methodical. When you set up an incubator, you have to ensure that people from these two or three cadres, namely successful entrepreneurs and VC funders, somehow come to your place and interact with these individuals. While actual VC funding is important, but it's not as important as interaction with those who do this VC fund, because interaction with them tells the youngsters how they will be evaluated. What is it that the VCs are looking for? What is it that the successful entrepreneurs have done? We did all that in the early days. The Thai chapter in Mumbai helped us a lot. Thai has now chapters in Mumbai, in Bangalore, in Delhi. Delhi chapter is also doing quite well. I have been talking to the Thai India people saying set up chapters in other places. Don't stick to metros and so on. They said that they will try and set up a chapter in every city of the country where there is a minimal amount of industrialization. So I do not know, for example, whether in Rajasthan and Tamil Nadu there are chapters like that. But in the absence of Thai, you may want to tag on to the local Commerce and Industry Association. You may want to tag on to the local successful entrepreneurs. There would definitely be some in every city and every town, although they remain aloof from the academic environment because they do their own business. But if you are running an incubator, you have to bring them on board. As a matter of fact, we have found that there is an additional advantage. Such people invariably start talking about the research programs, start talking about the educational programs, and they give valuable inputs. So it works. It works to be very useful either way. In the initial days, we used to give them, because it was a IT pilot incubator, we used to give them some computers, internet, roughly about 5 lakhs rupees worth of equipment and infrastructure we would spend per company. And then after 1 year, we said you will have to start paying rental charges if you don't get out, because there has to be some money. I wanted someone to take charge of this and to formalize this process, and I could not find someone till one day I got an application from a startup company, two of whom whose proprietors were based in Pune. They had listed one name, Professor Dr. Rajan Lagu, as the advisor, technical advisor. I didn't tell them I knew Lagu. Rajan Lagu, by the way, was IIT Bombay student, BTEC, one of my favorite students. Went to the industry, did his PhD, came back and taught for some time, and had gone back and set up his own company in signal processing in Pune. So I just told them, I want to meet your technical advisor. Please get him here. He came. Next week he came. It was then that the young students came to know that I already knew Lagu and so on, because Lagu must have told them that. So I asked him, what has happened to his company? He says, no, company is running fine, sir. My manager is running it, but there is nothing exciting that is happening. Whereas what is being attempted by these kids is very exciting, so I want to participate, I want to advise. So I said, but you are in Pune, these guys will be here. He says, no, I don't mind spending time in Mumbai. What about your wife and kid? Daughter is growing, wife works for an NGO, absolutely no problem. Then I asked him, why do you want to advise only one company? Would you mind advising everybody? He did not understand it first. I said, I need an advisor. I need a program director for the incubator. So why don't you join in as an advisor? And he says, but I have interest in this company. So I said, will it come in your way of advising others? He said, of course not. So I said, if you are convinced, I am convinced. I am not worried about it. You see, I was talking to you about the motives and objectives. The motives might not be understood and seen to be impartial by others. But if you are convinced, then you should not mind going ahead with that. But the person was absolutely valuable. A person who has actually set up a company, a person who has gone through the pains, a person who understands technology to the best of anybody's ability, PhD in computer science, in electrical engineering. Second, he has the passion. What better you ask? Such people you will not get by advertising in newspapers. You have to keep your eyes and ears open. And you will find them anywhere, anytime. And if you are traveling by train and you find that person in a bogey in your compartment, before that person gets out of the train, that person should be employed by you. You leave him, somebody else will employ. This is the only way to get good people. There is no other way. The fortunate privilege I had was, I had the freedom to do that. Because my director, others agreed, there were some negotiations. You know, he says, I can't come at a professor's salary. How much do you need? I need at least 50,000 rupees. So I went to my deputy director figured out, he says, we'll appoint him as a professor of entrepreneurship, a visiting professor. For 4 days a week, he will visit as a visiting professor, teach the entrepreneurship course, we'll pay him 25,000 rupees a month. For 1 day a week, when he consults with you, you pay him 25,000 rupees a month for that. Simple, problem solved. Why I tell you all this is that you have to figure out some innovative way. Not all good people will come free for you. Some will come free. Some will have a cost. Some will have a very large cost. 50,000 rupees was more than my salary, more than my director's salary. We did not hesitate in agreeing to pay that because that person was worth more than that. The contributions are, of course, extraordinary. What you see as a successful incubator today in the form of SIDE would not have happened if people like these were not available. He spent religiously 5 days a week. He mentored each and every team. Additionally, he started converting ad hoc processes that I had set up into a formalized set of processes. Again, in IIT, this is probably a style. There are a few people like me who are usually chosen to create new initiatives. Because when you create new initiatives, existing rules don't apply. There are no defined processes. And as a matter of fact, you have to break some rules. So people like me are called commandos. You typically send commandos to break and vanquish everything in the way. But such people have to be followed by a team of legitimizers, you know, stabilizers. So people like Professor Sarda, Professor Amarnath, they will follow up and they will make rules and they will make procedures. So establishing law and order is the second activity. I am not suggesting that you break all the rules, but I am also suggesting that do not set up only law and order. You will need a combination of both, some innovative disruption at the beginning and very carefully planned processes at the end. And throughout the transition, you will sometimes require this, sometimes require this. Don't hesitate in using whatever is appropriate at that point in. Pure play commando activity, pure play breaking of rules, etc. will only result in chaos. You need system. But a pure play system, extremely well-defined procedure, will have a very well-established and operationally running incubator without any success rate as you define. Same thing about quantity and quality. You cannot convert one from the other. Same thing about breaking the rules and framing the rules. One is not a substitute for other. You require both. Our history has taught up, taught us a lot of these things, mainly the freedom to act in the initial days. And this freedom must be embodied in whatever structure you give to your incubator, to your CEO, and it must pass down equally well to everybody down the line. I'll give a simple example. Now, the school of IT has been merged back with the computer science department. But in the school, we followed this philosophy where everybody was enabled to take a decision. If, let's say, something goes wrong somewhere and to fix it, whether it's an electrical circuit or whatever, requires an expenditure of 200 rupees, not a large sum. The project assistant in charge of that activity would first spend those 200 rupees, buy that thing, fix it, and then ask for reimbursement. In a conventional department structure, in my own department of computer science, the concerned person will first prepare a draft saying, please approve 200 rupees. And if the professor in charge of that lab is missing for 10 days, nothing will happen for those 10 days. This is how government departments are run. This is how, unfortunately, some institutions are run. Never, ever even permit such thought process to enter into any incubator that you run. If you run your incubator like that, I'm guaranteeing that it will fail. It will not work. If you are setting up an incubator, advise all the people down the line that each one of them exists to serve the startup companies. The startup companies don't exist to satisfy your rule book. If a startup company has a problem, if a telephone is not working, a PC is not working, network is down, water is not there in the cooler, electric supply is erratic, whatever. If that problem is not solved in 24 hours, somebody must be fired. And if somebody is not fired, the CEO should fire himself or herself. Believe me, this might appear harsh because it is not our normal way of life. I am humbly suggesting that that should be our normal way of life for everything that we do. But if we can't tradition of the so-called government department, then you must set up different traditions here. And believe me, the traditions that you once set, they will continue. Today, SIGN is an established organization. But even today, if any startup in SIGN has the smallest of the problem, there is a person who is responsible to solve that problem. That kind of setup is what we learned as a very important lesson. See, we talk of infrastructure, computers, or whatever other equipment that you have, furniture, telephone. As I said, it's a people's game. And you want people to concentrate on building business, building products. You don't want them to concentrate on running after a fused wire or whatever. That is your job. If the incubator can't do that, then incubator is not useful. This is the most important lesson we have learned. This is not the only thing, but it is an important thing. Over and above that is the notion of mentoring. Today we have a mentoring panel, successful entrepreneurs from the Mumbai region and others, they come and regularly mentor our startup. In those days, this would be done sort of informally. Yeah, please.
Yeah, I'm Prasad from Niti speaking. The mother organization and the incubator, what kind of relationship is required to be, what kind of...
This question will be answered by SIGN.
I do understand, but I definitely want to listen from you a bit.
The relationship should be that of a complementary nature. Whatever be the structure, the incubator must be able to operationally function completely independent of the mother organization. If it can't, it is not an incubator, it is a department of the parent organization. Incubator requires a different mindset to run. Parent organization will have a different mindset because its purpose is different. The objective here is different. You do ask this question to Professor Amarnath and others and also to the last panel. We have actually a board. The board level thing is common. So Professor Mishra, our director, is on the board. IIT Bombay owns the site. The chairman of the board is Ashank Desai. Of course, the director views are considered most important. Of course, even important regular decisions in the SIGN are taken at least after informing him, if not taking his permission. but sign runs independent. So that is definitely an important lesson that we learned from. We also learned how to evaluate the proposers better. In the early days, we had no clue. I would personally do some evaluation using my own colleagues' opinions, and those which would filter upward, I will send them to my friends like Ashank Desai or Praveen Gandhi or Harish Mehta or somebody saying, because it was an IT incubator, we could get that. Valuation was a huge thing. The first valuation that was done when the VC funding to be done for the first startup, that is writeoff.com, which is Kashyap Devra's company. So Rakesh Mathur, who was one of their mentors, Nandan Nilekani and I were the three people committed deciding how to do the valuation. And a newspaper reporter tagged it. She was quite excited that something of this sort is happening here. We had a meeting in Hotel Ambassador, and they made a presentation, and we looked at the possible things, etc., etc., but we did not bicker for too long. And then Nandan and Rakesh looked at each other, and Nandan looked at me and said, "What do you feel, Prof. Phatak?" I said, "These guys should be helped, they are doing well." Then Nandan asked Rakesh, how much do they require? They require about 1 crore rupees. So then Nandan says, "All right, I am not interested, Rakesh, why don't you fund?" Rakesh said, "All right." So should we say we put the value of the company at about 5 crores? So why 5 crores? Because they require about 1 crore rupees, and 20% of 5 crores is 1 crore. And the matter ended there. So the newspaper reporter was completely surprised. She thought a lot of spreadsheets will be done and calculation done, etc., etc. And she asked Nandan, "So when are you going to do the valuation?" Nandan said, "It just got completed." And she then further asked this question. So Nandan said, "Look, you must understand two things. None of the three people sitting here are interested one bit in that company or making money out of that company. We all want this to succeed because this is amongst the first ones. Secondly, even if we had to do a very detailed evaluation, we are unlikely to have come up with much different figure than this. This comes out of our gut feel. We are talking to both the people who have experienced it. And thirdly," he says, "we don't have time to bicker. They need money yesterday evening." Sometimes, friends, and I have participated subsequently in more detailed valuations. You calculate a whole lot of ratios. This is, you know, doing a valuation of a company when the company is already in business is much easier. You can actually verify the projections and so on. Angel funding, how do you do valuation? Okay, it's still a mystery to me. But you still have to figure out how you do that. What Professor Lagu's maximum contribution was in coming up with this model of discharging our share. So suppose we have 3% share or 6% share, some n percent share in a company. He said holding it perpetually, which was my original idea, is not useful because the VCs would be very uncomfortable if you don't dilute your share. You suddenly become a very important stakeholder. So he suggested that we discharge 1/3 on the first round of funding. So like they got 1 crore for 20%. Suppose I am holding 3% in them. Today I will say that, okay, you're buying 20% of his, you buy 1% of my share also and pay me cash. When he gets second round of funding, whatever is the valuation at the second round, we will discharge another 1/3 of our share. And 1/3 we will hold optionally for a $1 billion IPO. In case that fellow does a $1 billion IPO, even 1% would be good. Nandan endorsed this, Kamal endorsed this, everybody endorsed this, saying that's a good idea because this permits a cash flow to the incubator as every round of funding happens. And it also holds you some share for a prospective non-linear increase in wealth in case the company does well. I'm very proud to tell you that later when Department of Science and Technology wanted IITs to start such incubators, they invited proposals. Our proposal was made by Professor Lagu, and when it was sent, the DST committee called all IITs and said, "We like your initiatives, but the way the proposal has been made by IIT Bombay appears to be most realistic and well done. Please rewrite your proposals on those lines, we'll approve all of them." So IIT Bombay's proposal was accepted as a sort of benchmark. The sign today has all the procedures on the website, and do ask Poini if you have any additional questions, but please do use those as models, not necessarily because they will fit your thing. They may not. You may have to modify them. But that is because they have come out of a lot of experience and maramari and corrections and whatever. As I said, without people such as Professor Lagu or Arvind Patel or the, of course, the great supporters like Kamal Rekhi and Nandan, and without the enthusiastic participation of the startup community. Don't forget that if I found these funny negotiations going on at 2 o'clock, at 2 o'clock those people were actually awake and conducting these negotiations and working. As a matter of fact, I remember this happened with MyZeus fellow. Every time I go out, twice or thrice a week, I'll just pass by that, and I'll find a fellow sleeping in a sleeping bag, two people actually. And I'll find the same people sleeping there. So one day during the daytime, I confronted them and I said, you have a lot of sleeping partners. Every time I see that fellow sleeping only. He said, sir, we take turns in sleeping. So we have 4 hour sleeping shifts. Because there's a limited 10 by 10 room, we have more people. So people will sleep for 4 hours, they will work, then again they will. And he says, unfortunately, every time you walk back home in the night, that is the time when these people have sleeping turn. So you see the same people sleeping, but believe me, they are awake most of the time and they are working. The incubators work 24 hours. Lights never went off. So even today, for example, in the incubator companies that we have mostly in Sign, if you go to Sign, Saturday, Sunday, whatever, day, night, not everybody, but some place you will find some joker working. That must be the ethos. If you have startup companies in your incubator which lock their offices by 5 o'clock in the evening as your institutions do, then there is something drastically wrong with that. And this ethos will not come automatically. In the initial days, this ethos will come by the participating faculty members actually spending time. You don't need to do anything worthwhile. I never did anything worthwhile as far as their technology development was concerned. But just walk in after dinner, say hello, how are you, kya ho raha hai, khane ko theek hai, pani milta hai, bijli hai, what are your problems, when are you getting married, just talk shop, develop context. All that they want is a human being to listen to them as a human being. That's all. It solves half the problems. The remaining half they are capable of solving. If they were not, they would not be doing what they are doing any. But this is very, very important. They should perceive that there is some elder in the family who is there to look after them in case they are in a problem. And of course, occasionally they will come up with real problems, some of which you can't solve. You have to tell them. The other thing that I learned is that in the early days, this is important that I should convey to you, immediately after the first round of funding, at least one of the startups, I explicitly saw that, and it happened with actually two startups, suddenly, the students were moving in a car, they were moving with expensive mobile phones, and I felt something was amiss. And nothing wrong in moving in expensive cars. I like to move in expensive cars, but I have worked for 35 years to earn that kind of money to move in expensive cars. And that money was not earned by them from their customers. That money was earned, not earned really, given as a loan by a venture capitalist fund. And I inquired, they said, no, we have to meet, prospective customers, etc. I was not fooled by that because the prospective customers do not come to see what car you are traveling. You could very well go in a local train and still meet. One of the two companies exited just about okay, but collapsed later on. The other company actually broke up while getting incubated. There could be many other reasons, but I do attribute that reason to the propensity of the individual to get enamored by the lot of money that you receive, and instead of using that money, every paisa of it, in appointing new people or buying something that is required or marketing or whatever, spending it on yourself. When you mentor your startups, keep a small eye on such things. Keep a small eye on how the young people are likely to be tempted more to do this kind of thing than slightly older people. And young or old, this is not good. And this has to be told in no uncertain terms. In short, you have to behave with the startup companies exactly like a father would behave with children. Extremely concerned in the heart, willing to solve any problem of theirs, looking after them, making your presence felt, but being stern when required, inculcating discipline when it is essential. And the last lesson I learned from Kamal is, do not overdo the act of supporting them. The example that he gave was a famous, if you have seen the young birds when they start growing old, the mother actually pushes them from the culvert. The child bird is terribly worried, you know, it will die. But the mother knows that unless pushed on the brink, the child will not fly. You have to take that attitude. So he says, basically saying don't fondle them too much. Let them face the reality of their life. Let them face the music of their life. Be behind them, but don't try to shield them from the real. They have to face the real world. That is only when they will learn. And some will fail. That's okay. So this is how today we have this sign, the transition from this great startup experiment to the ultimate structured society that you see today. You shall go through it tomorrow. As I said, Professor Sarda and Professor Lagu in absentia will be talking to you. And three of the startup companies, two at the beginning, these two people, as I said, the pilot. And then Girish will be talking to you tomorrow evening. Day after tomorrow, the entire day will be spent on defining and describing the formal structures that we have arrived at. I would like you to form an independent opinion after going through this sort of growth or the transition. Not all of you would necessarily have to go through the same problems that we have faced. Today, the situation is much different. Department of Science and Technology and other agencies are willing to give you some funding. There's a better understanding. You can start off at a different level already. But there are also some shortcomings of starting off with a formal process. Namely, you will do very well in defining quantitative measures and terms, but you may miss out on the qualitative things. One of the reasons I wanted to share with you the stories is to tell you that there are very, very interesting and fascinating qualitative aspects of life when you try to set up and run an incubator. And I think if you inculcate some of those and pass on the message to others, perhaps that will make life, if nothing else, more interesting and probably more useful. I will now request, as I told you, my friend Dr. Sridhar Shukla is here. I would, his company is not one which has been incubated in IIT. But he is one of the greatest supporters of IIT in many of its activities. I'll request him to spare some 10 minutes of his time to share with you how he sorted out problems when he was leading a startup and incubating without an incubator. Perhaps that would also be useful. Perhaps, Dr. Shukla, you may want to share with them what problems you faced and how an incubator could have possibly helped you solve those problems. Because then they can take that down as an agenda item for their. Dr. Sridhar Shukla for you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Phatak. It's always fun to be here. He's the one who taught me the first programming course in 1981, some time back. And we keep coming here to get motivated by him and the whole environment here. So you asked me to speak for 10 minutes. I just walked in. I don't know what has been discussed before. But the topic is about incubation. So, as he introduced, I have no real qualification because no company I have worked with has been incubated out of an incubator. But I would say this is the second company that I have experience with. To tell you my background very quickly so that you get a perspective on my color. Electrical engineer, 83 from here, master's, PhD somewhere in the US. 6 years doing that, then 6 years of being a prof at a university. Back in 95 with persistent for 8 years. as it grew from say 25 to 500, and then almost five years back started one company with a high school classmate to create some products. So with this experience on the topic of incubation, I would like to say only a couple of things. I will of course elaborate on them. I understand the audience is interested in setting up incubators at their particular organizations. And then what kind of support you should give to people at your institutions who want to create startups and fly out. So the first item is provide adult supervision. And that means a few things. When somebody young and enthusiastic with some fantastic goals and the energy to take them to conclusion start off, someone has to be there to keep giving them the dose. So the first dose would be teach them to survive. I mean, that's what mothers or parents of young ones in any aspect of animal life to do, they teach their young ones to survive. So in this area of technology or creating a startup, survival would mean solve a problem that some all the time. So solving a problem is basic, because then that's where you bring your skill in. And if somebody is willing to pay for, you actually get revenue. It may not lead to an earth-shaking product right away, but it's definitely something that gets you started and lets you survive. We have found a number of people, including ourselves, going the route of, I want to create something that's going to create a revolution. But many a successful company just start by surviving. The second item I have is, at no point should the incubator organization let the startup forget that they must have a long-term view. Because if they are going to get acquired in X number of quarters for Y million dollar valuation, then I think people are chasing fantasy. It may never get fulfilled. And it just does not bring out the true commitment. So it has to be, I have a long I want to create something of value in this area. Continue doing this. When that is there, talk to prospective customers. They will get confident that these guys will support me and won't make merry after they get acquired. That invest in all the time. Long term. The third point I have is, once again, very important that almost people, no matter how seasoned, need, is to keep a focus on satisfied, profitable, and growing customer base. If there is no customer, you are in no business. It has to be a satisfied customer, because he is going to help you grow. And the guys need to have the ability to satisfy them, which is many times not there. The customer base has to be growing, otherwise you really don't have a market. And thirdly, it has to be profitable, otherwise you're all doing this for no reason. So these three qualities of what customer community people talk to have to be identified by the incubator companies all the time. And at any cost, headstrong behavior from entrepreneurs has to be prevented. Because if they have an idea, headstrongness is certainly good, but you can't have a bloody head while doing it. You can't go under. So I have created something, and I know if it's of value, but a few people don't buy it, on. There's no point in sticking to it. So I would say these are qualitative aspects of providing adult supervision, which are a must and which are required frequently. The classic example I like to give is we all get taught as children that you must eat right and exercise. I don't know how many actually manage to do that. It's a lifelong struggle for most of us. So that way you need a reminder for the basics all the time, and the incubator should do that. So that's really the longer item. The second aspect for which I think I heard Professor Phatak refer to quickly is make your startups very efficient. A lot of valuable time is lost in doing things like sending offers, reaching out, doing screening. When you get a new customer, how to quickly qualify, writing a contract with them, creating basic collateral, creating a website. All of these things should happen snap of a finger because they are in an incubator. It should be common system administration services. When all of these are given and you take a walk around the place asking them about how well they are doing, I think that would be a great form. So I don't have much more to say. No.